In this video, we'll study about the 8th cranial nerve, the vestibulo-cochlear nerve. The vestibulo-cochlear nerve is attached to the junction between the pons and the medulla. So this is the pontomedullary junction. It lies behind and lateral to the facial nerve. So this is a facial nerve and this is the nervous intermedius and this is the vestibulo-cochlear nerve. So the vestibulo-cochlear nerve lies behind and lateral to the facial nerve with the nervous intermedius intervening between them. The vestibulo-cochlear nerve consists of two components, the vestibular component for equilibrium and the cochlear nerve for hearing. Close to the brainstem, the vestibular nerve lies ventromedial to the cochlear nerve. This is a schematic picture of the vestibulo-cochlear nerve. So this is the vestibular component. The vestibular nerve contains about 19,000 nerve fibers and presents the following functional components. You have the special proprioceptive fibers for static equilibrium from the sensitive hair cells of saccule and utricle. Next component is the special proprioceptive fibers for kinetic equilibrium from the hair cells of three semicircular ducts. The third component is it has few efferent fibers of olivocochlear bundle which reach the type 2 hair cells directly and the type 1 hair cells by making synapses with the terminal afferent boutons. Thereby, the efferent fibers modulate the degree of excitability by inhibition. Next, we'll see the cells of origin. The afferent fibers for both static and kinetic equilibrium takes origin from the bipolar neurons of the vestibular ganglion, or it is also known as the scarpus ganglion, which is situated in the trunk of the vestibular nerve at the bottom of the internal acoustic meatus. So this is the internal acoustic meatus. It is situated at the bottom of the internal acoustic meatus. The efferent fibers, they arise from the superior and accessory olivary nuclei of the pons from both ipsilateral and contralateral sides, and some efferent fibers extend from the vestibular to the cochlear nerve by the vestibulo-cochlear anastomosis, that is known as the Ott's bundle. So, Ott's bundle is the efferent fiber which extends from the vestibular nerve to the cochlear nerve by the vestibulo-cochlear anastomosis. Next, we'll see about the peripheral distribution of the vestibular nerve. The peripheral processes of the bipolar ganglion cells at the bottom of the internal acoustic meatus divides into upper, lower and posterior branches. The upper branch passes through the foramina of the superior vestibular area and they reach the macula of the utricle and the ampullary crest of the anterior and the lateral semicircular duct. The lower branch reaches the macula of the saccule through the foramina of the inferior vestibular area. The posterior branch enters through the foramen cingulate and ends in the ampullary crest of the posterior semicircular duct. The bottom of the internal acoustic meatus is limited by a plate of bone which is subdivided by a horizontal crest into an upper and lower area. The posterior part of the upper area presents the superior vestibular area and the posterior part of the lower area is occupied by the inferior vestibular area. The anterior part of the upper area presents an opening for the facial nerve. And the anterior part of the lower area displays the tractus spiralis foraminosus for the transmission of the cochlear nerve. Now we'll see about the vestibular pathway. So this is the bipolar vestibular ganglion, which is also known as the scarpus ganglion. From the ganglion, you get the peripheral process. This peripheral process supply the hair cells of maculae of the saccule and the utricle, and this is for static equilibrium. The peripheral processes also supply the hair cells of ampullary crest of the three semicircular duct, and this is for kinetic equilibrium. From the bipolar vestibular ganglion, the central processes, they form the vestibular nerve. Next we'll see the central connections. The fibers from the ampullary crest of the semicircular duct, they reach the superior and the medial vestibular nuclei, which are the components of the vestibular nucleus. The fibers from the maculae of the saccule and the utricle, they reach the medial and the inferior vestibular nuclei, which is also a component of the vestibular nucleus. So the vestibular nucleus has four components: superior, inferior, medial and lateral. The fibers from the maculae of the saccule and the utricle, they passes through the juxta restiform body and they reach the flocculonodular lobe of the cerebellum. The vestigial nucleus of both sides of the cerebellum is connected via the uncinate fasciculus to the vestibular nuclei. There is another connection from the Purkinje cells of the flocculonodular lobe. So these fibers connect to the lateral vestibular nuclei. The connection from the vestigial nucleus to the vestibular nuclei is facilitatory, whereas the connection from the Purkinje cells of the flocculonodular lobe to the lateral vestibular nuclei is inhibitory. Next we'll see about the efferents from the vestibular nucleus. The efferents from the vestibular nucleus, they approach the midline and they divide into ascending and descending branches with or without crossing. So these fibers forms the medial longitudinal fasciculus. So this medial longitudinal fasciculus, they gives collaterals to the nuclei of the oculomotor nerve, to the nucleus of the trochlear nerve, to the nucleus of the abducens nerve, to the nucleus of the facial nerve, and it is also connected to the nucleus of the hypoglossal nerve and the nuclei of the ventral gray column of the cervical segments of the spinal cord, which is related with the cranial part of the accessory nerve. Through this fasciculus, the vestibular system integrates the movement of the eye, head and neck. At the cranial end of the medial longitudinal fasciculus is supplemented by the fibers from the contralateral interstitial nucleus of Cajal. So some of the ascending fibers of the medial longitudinal fasciculus are relayed into the magnocellular part of the medial geniculate body, and thereafter it is projected to the head regions of the post-central gyrus, the area number 3, 1 and 2. Some of the fibers from the vestibular nuclei are projected to the ipsilateral flocculonodular lobe and the vestigial nucleus. A few efferent fibers from the superior and lateral vestibular nuclei, they retrace the course of the vestibular nerve, and these fibers reach the sensitive hair cells of maculae and cristae, and this is to modulate the sensory input or to alter the threshold of the hair cells. most of the efferents from the lateral vestibular nucleus, they descend ipsilaterally and they form the lateral vestibulospinal tract, and this tract extends in the anterior funiculus along the whole length of the spinal cord. From the medial vestibular nucleus, the efferent fibers, they form the medial vestibulospinal tract, which is composed of both crossed and uncrossed fibers, and this tract, they terminate into the lamina 7 and 8 of the spinal cord, which consists of interneurons. From there, the fibers end into the alpha and the gamma efferent neurons of the lamina 9. Some of the fibers, they directly ends in the alpha and gamma neurons of the lamina 9 without the interruption of the interneurons. So through this, the vestibulospinal tract, they stimulates the extensor motor neurons and they inhibit the flexor motor neurons. Through this tracts, they maintain the erect posture of the trunk. Next, we'll see about the cochlear nerve. The cochlear nerve contains about 23,500 fibers and they possess the functional components. The most of the fibers, they convey the special somatic sensation for hearing from the hair cells of the organ of cortex. You have few efferent fibers of olivocochlear bundle which reach the hair cells directly or indirectly to modulate the degree of excitability and to protect the hair cells from the loud sounds. The cells of origin are the afferent fibers arises from the bipolar ganglion cells which are situated within the spiral canal of the modulus. When you see the peripheral distribution, the peripheral processes of the bipolar spiral neurons, they bend successively outward to reach the attached margin of the osseous lamina after passing between the two tables of the osseous lamina. The nerve fibers, they ramify around the bases of the inner and the outer hair cells. Each inner hair cell receives connection from about 10 spiral ganglion cells, whereas one ganglion cell is connected with more than 10 outer hair cells. Next, we'll see about the central connections. The central processes of the ganglion cell, they pass through the tractus foraminosus at the bottom of the internal acoustic meatus and they unite to form the trunk of the cochlear nerve. At the lower border of the pons, the cochlear nerve passes a lateral to the inferior cerebral epidangle and they make synapses with the ventral and the dorsal cochlear nuclei. Next, we'll see about the central connections. The spiral ganglion cells, so they form the first order sensory neurons. So the central processes from the spiral ganglion cells, they divide into short ascending and long descending branches. So they terminate into the dorsal and the ventral cochlear nuclei and this forms the second order sensory neurons. So both the cochlear nuclei act as a second order sensory neurons and they are tonotopically arranged. The fibers from the apical turn of the cochlea, which is low turn, they terminate into the ventral cochlear nucleus and the ventral part of the dorsal cochlear nucleus. Whereas the fibers from the basal turn of the cochlea, which is for high tone, they terminate into the dorsal part of the dorsal cochlear nucleus. Next, we'll see about the efferents from the cochlear nuclei. First, connection is the fibers from the dorsal cochlear nucleus. They passes horizontally across the midline in the posterior part of the tegmentum, and they form the dorsal acoustic stria, and thereafter they ascends through the contralateral lateral lemniscus, and they terminate into the nucleus of the lateral lemniscus and inferior colliculus. The second connection is the fibers from the dorsal part of the ventral cochlear nucleus. They pass horizontally through the tegmentum, and they form the intermediate acoustic stria, and they join with the contralateral lateral lemniscus, and they terminate into the nucleus of the lateral lemniscus and inferior colliculus. The third connection is the fibers from the ventral cochlear nucleus. They traverse medially, and they form the ventral acoustic stria, and they decussate with the similar fibers of the opposite side, and they form the trapezoid body, and this terminate into the ipsilateral and contralateral superior olivary nuclear complex and the nucleus of the trapezoidium. This forms the third order sensory neuron, and finally they join with the lateral lemniscus. Some of the fibers from the ventral acoustic stria, they ascend uninterrupted and they join with the lateral lemniscus. So the lateral lemniscus composed of fibers from both second order and third order sensory neurons. So this from the fibers from here or third order sensory neurons, whereas the fibers from here or second order sensory neurons. From the nucleus of the lateral lemniscus, the fibers, they project into the inferior colliculus. The inferior colliculus acts as a sorting station of the auditory pathway. The fibers which are concerned with the hearing, they pass to the parvocellular part of the medial geniculate body. From there, they pass through the auditory radiation and terminate into the auditosensory cortex, the area number 41 and 42 of the temporal lobe. The fibers which are concerned with the auditory reflex, they connect the inferior colliculi of both sides by the commissural fibers. Some of the fibers which are concerned with the auditory reflex are connected to the superior colliculi, and from there you get the tectospinal and the tectobulbar tracts.